everybody. We're here in the beautiful waterside community of Sheepshead Bay, Brooklyn.
And there's lots to see, so don't go away.
Welcome to Breaking Bread. My name is Johanna Botta.
And I'm Monsignor Jamie, and today's show takes place in the beautiful church of St. Mark's in Sheepshead Bay. And today we're happy to have with us the pastor, the newly appointed pastor, Father Bob Mucci.
Welcome.
Bob, thank you. Thank you for having us.
Father Bob, this church got renovated in around 2001.
Correct.
What was the state in at the time?
Well, the church was originally built in 1929. And I think it, for a period of years, they really hadn't done very much. So it was when Monsignor Grimaldi became pastor that they had a capital campaign and raised a lot of money and tried to restore the church to its original beauty.
Which looks gorgeous right now.
Thank you.
And actually, this part right here, this is a replica from St. Paul's, correct?
Yes, which happens to be my favorite church in Rome. I studied in Rome for 6 years and loved St. Paul Outside the Walls. And when the bishop asked me to become pastor here back in October, I had never been inside the church. And as soon as I stepped in, I saw just how beautiful it was. So in particular, these medallions that we have going around near the ceiling. In St. Paul Outside the Walls, they have medallions of all the popes going back to St. Peter. Here we don't have the popes, we have saints and the Sacred Heart and images of Jesus, but they are very beautiful.
Now the church, St. Paul's Outside the Walls, why don't you tell us why it's called St. Paul's Outside the Walls?
Because it happens to be outside the walls that surround the city of Rome. It's one of the four major basilicas in Rome, where St. Paul himself is buried.
It's a beautiful church, I've been there many times, and the legend is that once all the medallions are filled with all the popes and there's no more space, it's the end of the world. Is that true? Or the Messiah will come, Jesus?
Oh no, how many are left?
It's true that that's the legend. Whether the legend is true, I couldn't tell you.
So what is the painting up there about?
Well, it's a replica of a famous painting by Raphael in Rome. You have the triumphant Christ with the Blessed Mother on one side, John the Baptist on the other, with God the Father up above.
That's beautiful. Wow.
So many beautiful things in this church. The baptismal font is beautiful also, I mean.
Yeah, originally there is a separate baptistry. Again, like so many churches in Rome, we've made that into a room with our statuary and shrines. Mm-hmm. And the baptismal font has the images of the four evangelists, you know, St. Mark being one of the evangelists.
Right.
There's also the symbols for Matthew and Luke and John as well.
Now, I understand that you recently had a Mardi Gras party here in the parish. It was a big party. Is that true?
It was. It was a great success. You know, after Hurricane Sandy, you know, there really weren't many parties going on.
Right.
And so as part of the community building, we looked to have a Mardi Gras party as, you know, signaling the beginning of Lent that was coming. And we probably had about 200 people. Tried to do a potluck supper kind of thing to keep the cost down. And but we had a band and a DJ, you know, lots of music and dancing, activities for the children. They actually made floats, like the Mardi Gras floats. And having studied in Rome, I had some good priest friends from New Orleans and Mobile who sent me some authentic things that the children could toss during the parade. It was really a wonderful time.
That's a great thing. It really brings a parish together when you have celebrations like that.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Father Bob, I also hear that you have a beautiful tree here.
We do. They call it the Adoration of the Christ display. And I had heard a lot about the tree when I was assigned here, but I really wasn't prepared for the unveiling that we did during Lessons and Carols. It really takes up the entire Blessed Mother altar on this right-hand side of the church. and besides the tree, which is adorned with angels, very similar to the tree at the Metropolitan Museum, it has a whole creche or nativity scene built in. There was running water in three places, and every figure has a little spotlight on it. And as they unveil the tree, they bring up lights on the different figures. It's really very, very moving.
So a creche is, I mean, I believe, I understand it, the tradition in a lot of Italian parishes that when they came from Italy, they came here to the United States, they would build their Christmas tree and they would build the town around the tree.
Right.
And they had all the little buildings and all the different houses in their town. So every creche is different. And everyone, and I understand here, they do a great job.
Sure.
That.
And it was all designed by one of our parishioners who is an artist, and it's spectacular. You'll have to come back one time to see the tree.
So how do you like the neighborhood, the parish? I know you're newly appointed here as pastor.
Oh, I love it here. I mean, this is a community in the truest sense of the word. You know, with some people with deep roots that go back for many years and many new people just having moved in. And so it really is an honor to be a part of it.
I feel at home here.
Very much, very
and
much.
Also, you know, the church, you know, being a replica of St. Paul outside the walls, you've been there. And it was my understanding, too, that the bell tower is a replica of the bell tower in St. Mark's in Venice.
Really?
Now, I don't know if it's true or not. A lot of traditions and you know, a lot of stories we hear.
Sure. I wouldn't be surprised because that is St. Mark's also in Venice, San Marco, the Piazza.
So this is a great fit for you.
Absolutely.
Interesting church.
And a very vibrant community, too.
Yeah. Up next, we're headed to a place not too far from here, right on Emmons Avenue.
So stay tuned.
Welcome back to Breaking Bread.
We're heading over to the very warm and inviting waterside restaurant, Yiasou.
As you turn onto Emmons Avenue, you can see it has its share of seafood restaurants. But Yiasou on the Bay is more than that. It's seafood with a Greek twist. Located at 2003 Emmons Avenue, right off Ocean Avenue, Yiasou has a Mediterranean charm that's hard to match. Unsurpassed by its fresh and authentic specialties, here they serve up amazing grilled seafood dishes, as well as lamb and buttery spanakopita, along with other Greek classics.
So we're here in the kitchen of Yiasou on the Bay,
which is known for its excellent Greek food, and here with us is executive chef Michael Kasitkis. Thank you so much for having us, Michael.
My pleasure.
Okay, so Michael, tell us a little bit more about the restaurant. It's you and your dad who own it, right?
Well, yeah, my father owns it, but it's a family restaurant. My mother, my brother, we're all in it together. My father's been in the restaurant business for over 40 years, so we're confident in what we do.
This is a great location. I mean, it's right in front of the water.
Yeah, it's Emmons Avenue. Come summertime, everybody's out.
You just go out there and like catch your own fish?
No, it's not the cleanest water over here.
But a lot of the boats come in here, they go fishing.
Right, they go out.
Where did you learn how to cook?
My father. He learned through his parents Greek.
Great.
So they cook in the kitchen all day.
That's good.
Tell us a little bit more about Greek food. What are some staples of Greek food that you have here at the restaurant?
Extra virgin olive oil, that's a big. Wine.
Feta cheese?
Feta cheese, of course.
What's a good dessert? Because I'm really into desserts here.
Baklava. Baklava is a very good one we have. We have a galaktaburko, which is a custard.
A kaburkova?
A lot of honey on there, right?
It's a galaktaburko. It's a custard dessert. Very good.
Not even gonna try to, you know, pronounce that.
Obviously, but you have a lot of fish dishes also,
yes,
right?
Yes, we focus on our fish.
Great.
That's our main. We have all fresh fish daily.
So what are we preparing today?
Today we're preparing a halibut speciotico. It's a filet piece of halibut, and just putting our style sauce in it.
Halibut
speciotico.
Show us what you've got going here.
Okay. Well, here's our piece of halibut. It's about 10 ounces. All right. What I like to do is I like to cut it in half.
Salt?
Salt it. A little pepper. And then drain the flour. You want to take the extra flour off. You don't want to burn it. You want to put the fish on the skin side up.
garlic.
Put a little bit of garlic in there. Would you like to put the cherry tomatoes in?
I would love to put the cherry tomatoes in.
Nice job. Look at that. Yeah.
You want to cook it a little bit?
They get a little transparent there?
Right. Would you like to put the towels in?
Oh, sure. Why not?
Sure.
There we go.
Got some capers.
Love capers. Okay. Now, are these sauces very...
Whoa, look at that.
We
don't even have alcohol in there. Look at that.
Now we're going to put some wine.
Whoa, look at that. Getting those flavors already.
Yeah.
Right. Here's our scampi sauce.
Okay. Now, what's in that scampi sauce?
The scampi sauce is a buttered garlic with some wine. Okay, we like to pre-cook it easier for us, and it's a nice flavor to it. Put a little chicken broth in.
Smell that aroma there. Yeah. Is this one of your more popular dishes on the menu?
Yes, it's a popular dish.
So much.
My
this
pleasure.
Halibut is delicious.
I'm glad you enjoyed it.
And if you want to come to Yiasou, which I highly recommend, here's the information. And if you want to try this dish at home, which I also highly recommend, here's the recipe. Delicious.
It was great.
But up next, we have Monsignor Jamie cooking one of his favorite recipes.
So don't go away. Welcome back to Breaking Bread. Today on our cooking segment, I'll be preparing an orzo salad. It's a great summer dish. And even though we just came from a great Greek restaurant at Yiasou, I grew up in Astoria, so I have a few Greek dishes myself. Let's try it. Today's orzo salad will be made with, of course, orzo that I just cooked and chilled it out. I rinsed it with cold water to get all the starch out. We have here feta cheese, cherry tomatoes, sliced black olives, toasted pinoli nuts or pine nuts, pepper, lemon juice, and olive oil, and fresh arugula. We'll start with the fresh arugula. I just cleaned it, rinsed it, put in our spinner to get all the water out. These are great. No more washing 5 times and then drying with a half a roll of paper towel. Once we have the arugula, we'll put it here and we're just gonna chop it up. Once we get it chopped up where we can work with it, then we'll start chopping. As I said earlier, this is a great summer dish because you can prepare it the night before as well. It's a cold dish. It goes well with barbecues, meat, goes good with sandwiches, or just to have a nice light lunch and a nice salad. We'll take our orzo, and I did cook this ahead of time, and after I rinsed it to get all the starch out and to chill it down, I did throw in some olive oil so it doesn't stick together. So there's some olive oil in there already. Okay, just loosen this up a little bit because it was sitting in the bowl. Now it's very important that when you make the orzo that you do rinse it and you chill it. You do not want to make this while the orzo is still hot, because once you put the feta cheese in, it'll start melting. Okay, so here we have our orzo. And now, first thing I'll throw in will be the feta cheese. Okay. Mix that in a little bit. Now you can get feta cheese whole and cube it, or you can get the crumbled feta cheese, whatever you like. Okay, throw in the black olives. What I like about this dish is that it's very colorful, because you have a lot of contrasting colors in here. You have white, black, red, green, almost like that. We'll throw in pine nuts. Now these were just pine nuts and I roasted them. I just sprayed a little oil on them and I just put them in the oven for a few minutes just to toast them. You don't have to toast them. You can put them in as you know, right from the jar or the package that you buy them in. We then throw in the tomatoes, cherry tomatoes. I just rinse them off. I now have the olive oil. And what I do is I have some freshly squeezed lemon juice. I'll mix that in with the olive oil. Just mix that together a little bit. And just throw that all on top. And that's basically the dressing. Fresh lemon juice and olive oil. Mix that a little bit. And then the final touch will be the chopped arugula. Just throw that in there. Let's incorporate that first. When you're mixing, it's always good to go to the bottom of the dish and just pull it up right up the center, almost like a volcano, because a lot of time all the flavors and all the ingredients settle on the bottom, and when people mix, they just mix the top. It's so important to go right to the bottom and just stir up. And that's true also when you're making a sauce or something on top of the stove, a stew, go to the bottom and just come up the center. And just think of a volcano. So here we have our orzo salad. If you like to make this dish at home or this summer, here's the recipe. And if you have a recipe that you would like us to try here on Breaking Bread, please send it to us at breakingbread@thesalesmedia.org. Today we visited the parish of St. Mark in Sheepshead Bay, Brooklyn. As we all know, St. Mark is one of the four gospel writers. It is in St. Mark's Gospel that we as Christians find the words of Jesus, which leads the early church community to move away from the kosher laws that they have come to know as Jews, to the understanding that we do not need strict dietary laws. In chapters 7, verses 18 and 19, St. Mark recounts Jesus' saying, "Don't you see that nothing that enters a man from the outside can make him unclean? For it doesn't go into his heart, but into his stomach, and then out of his body." Jesus reminds us all that it is not what we wear or what we eat that affects our relationship with God. Rather, it is what we feel in our hearts and how we act that affects our relationship with the Lord and causes us to do good or to sin. This is Monsignor Jamie Gigantiello asking that together we continue to build the church by devoting ourselves to community, to prayer, the teaching of the apostles, and the breaking of the bread. May God bless you. Thanks for watching.